So Paxlovid is the medication that Pfizer has introduced to treat symptomatic COVID disease. And it essentially works by binding to protease, which is an enzyme that's the virus needs for replication. So by sort of taking that out of action, it prohibits the virus itself from replication. And it would be essentially used similar to how we might use Tamiflu for patients with influenza. So early in the course of illness for several days, I think it's a five-day course, a couple times a day, that could reduce your progression of severity. It could reduce your likelihood of hospitalization or death. And so it can be certainly one of the more useful tools that we have to treat symptomatic patients who have COVID-19. Its availability will be regulated, certainly initially, I think through the federal government and the states. They will determine specific allocations. I don't believe you can actually request a specific number, or they will make some decisions about that allocation. And then I believe the expectation is that those who receive doses of Paxlovid also have to report use, similar to what we've done with vaccines. So data will have to be shared as to how much of it is you're actually using. And so we don't yet know when that will be available, and we certainly don't yet know when it will be widely available, but we're looking forward to having it. The recommendations for different populations vary, but if you're specifically looking at what to do while in quarantine, I think they're fairly consistent in that you really do want to try to be isolated physically as much as possible from other individuals in that household. And although that's a challenge to do, it's important if you really want to reduce the risk of transmission. And that really means wearing a mask pretty much at all times, unless you're alone by yourself in a closed room, not sharing household items, not really eating together, because that's a potential activity that could put people at high risk. It's really, I think, diligent physical isolation and being very attentive to try to do everything you can to minimize the risk of transmission. At this point, no, you really can't, because it really depends on the individual's response to the virus, and any individual could respond differently. So one person might have very low-grade symptoms, another person might have very severe symptoms. We've seen with Omicron, not only those symptoms appear to be more mild in general, but more consistent with things that we would see symptoms for other respiratory illnesses, or even sometimes allergies that you wouldn't consider something that's associated with, say, the earlier, more concerning symptoms we saw, like fever, shortness of breath, severe cough. Those can also occur with Omicron, but you can't really rule out a particular variant simply by the symptoms. You can't tell by symptoms alone. Certainly, you could get a test. PCR test could determine whether you're infected with influenza or with COVID-19 or both. But it really requires some sort of a specific test to determine what kind of those viruses you might be infected with. Unfortunately, we're seeing a lot of other respiratory viruses go up along with flu. Rhinovirus and enterovirus, adenovirus, human metapneumovirus, even the non-COVID coronaviruses, which is something that we track, are also increasing. The only thing we've seen a decrease in fairly recently is RSV to some extent, which is a little unusual, but we did have an out-of-season peak, you know, earlier last year. But for the most part, there's so many other, particularly respiratory viruses, that are in circulation right now and increasing that, you know, people who have COVID-like symptoms could have one of those as well. Well, it's concerning. I think the good news from last flu season was we really didn't see a whole lot of laboratory confirmed flu. And I think a majority of that had to do with the human behaviors that people were exhibiting. Diligent mask wear and distancing were probably a lot more prevalent a year ago than they were this time of year. So that said, we are already seeing higher numbers and higher rates of influenza in our community that we've confirmed through our own laboratory, which means you could theoretically be co-infected with both viruses. Now, we don't know if that in and of itself could make it more severe, but certainly your body having to fight off two different respiratory viruses at the same time is something you'd want to avoid. Yes, there have been studies to document that you can have two different variants of SARS-CoV-2 at the same time. It's probably not in and of itself something that would be a more severe case clinically. We don't know. I think it takes a very special situation to be able to determine that, because you'd have to sequence both viruses from samples from an individual patient, which is not something that's regularly done. But with overlap of the prevalence of one variant with another, it's certainly possible that an individual could be co-infected with both at the same time. I would say absolutely not. There's a lot we don't know about this virus, and we certainly don't know the long-term effects of coronavirus, because we've only been dealing with it, at least this variant, SARS-CoV-2, for about 2 years now. So in and of itself, trying to avoid infection to prevent the long-term effects of what we're calling long COVID, I think is something that's worth doing. Similarly, so, you know, every individual has a different response to being infected. And collectively at a population level, we're seeing perhaps a smaller percentage of individuals that are having severe illness as compared to the Delta variant. Any individual patient can get severe disease. In fact, we're having clearly patients who are still being admitted to the hospitals. We know our hospitalization rates are going up. Omicron is probably the dominant, if not the only variant now we're seeing in our community. So it's contributing to increased hospitalizations, and we're still seeing mortalities. And so we know Omicron in of itself can still cause hospitalization, severe disease, and death. Well, I don't know if we can predict. I think there's certainly a hope that this wave could be different. And some of that is based on the trends that we're seeing come out of South Africa, where the virus was originally identified. They have started to see a decline in the frequency of their cases. In fact, a rapid decline, which if it happens similarly here, would potentially mean we have a surge that's of shorter duration and perhaps one that comes down fairly quickly. What we don't yet know is how high that peak will go, and if truly it will be a shorter period.